Welcome to the Social Business Engine Podcast,
where today's thought leaders discuss how they're using the latest social media strategies and technologies in marketing, sales, customer service, and HR. Get ready to be inspired as our guests contribute to your digital transformation through their stories, knowledge, and insights into what works in today's digitally connected world. And now, here's Bernie Borges, your host of the Social Business Engine Podcast.
Hey there, welcome to episode 225. This is Bernie Borges, CMO of Ingresso and host of the Social Business Engine Podcast. Hey, thanks for listening. Hey, my guest on this episode is Basile Senesi, head of sales and support at a company called Fundbox. Now, you're going to hear how this innovative company is providing a solution to a long-standing need in most businesses, and that is access to credit. And hey, they do this with data, automation, and the human touch. Now, if that sounds like a winning combination, it is. Don't go anywhere because you're going to hear all about it from Basile Senesi at Fundbox. Now, this episode is sponsored by Conversica, AI software for marketing and sales that fosters real conversations to discover the most qualified sales opportunities. Learn more at conversica.com. And now, here's my conversation with Basile Senesi, head of sales and support at Fundbox. Basile, welcome to the Social Business Engine Podcast.
Bernie, thank you so much for having me. I'm excited.
Absolutely. Well, let's get right into an introduction to your company, Fundbox. Very cool name, very different. So who is Fundbox? And Basile, what is your role in the company?
Absolutely, Bernie. Well, Fundbox is a small business lending platform. We specialize in giving small business owners access to capital and credit to grow their business. And I oversee our sales and customer support operation here at Fundbox, which is a team of 200 across two countries. And my sales and support teams themselves amount to about 30 people between two offices.
Okay. And you oversee customer acquisition and support?
That's correct, which is a little bit strange, I think, for a tech company. But the philosophical kind of voice that we take there is, you know, I am the person in charge of the voice of the customer. And regardless of whether they're potentially a customer, an existing customer, have been a customer with us for a long time, we want to have one unified approach, one unified philosophy in communicating with them. And so we oversee both teams kind of under one umbrella.
Okay. So in one regard, Basile, you're in a very traditional business because businesses for decades, if not centuries, have needed access to money. But you're doing it in a very innovative way. So why don't you expand on that, your whole business model?
Absolutely. So, you know, I think you hit on a very good point, which is lending hasn't fundamentally changed that much since its inception. It's really been based on one of two things. What does your personal financial history look like? Or what are you willing to put up in exchange for money today if you're unable to pay? Think of it as, you know, financial credit history or collateral being the two main drivers of underwriting. And realistically, while that made sense when we didn't live in the data-connected world we're in today, that's changed fundamentally over the past few years, over the past decade or so. What Fundbox does differently is challenge the underwriting standards that companies have relied on since the mid-50s to provide Empower loans. And what I mean by that more specifically is we try to look at new sources of information that business owners feed data into for the purposes of underwriting and understanding their business financial health, rather than looking at their traditional credit history or requiring extensive collateral, provide them with funding. That manifests itself in a few examples. To give you kind of, you know, a more specific answer there, that translates from things like integrating with a QuickBooks accounting software system all the way to analyzing a business bank account and everything in between.
Okay. Well, I think that's a good segue to sort of an explanation of your business model from the standpoint of how you go to market, right? Because in this podcast, we help marketers understand how to be competitively unique and different and stand out, you know, above the whatever the noisy crowd may be in their market space. So why don't you talk a little bit about that, Basile, in terms of how do you guys go to market?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, I think the interesting thing with credit, as the past decade or two has really taught us, is it's not something you can force upon people without bad consequences. You really have to educate the market on understanding how credit can help power their growth and help their business. And you have to make sure that on the other side of the customer spectrum, the people that are coming to your company are taking on loans that are good for them, that aren't going to put them into a trap or a debt spiral that puts them in a worse position in trying to get through a rainy day. And I think, you know, the market's really taught us that in the past decade or so, especially after the Great Recession, giving access to credit in a very educated way is going to be the way forward, not just for our company, but for every lending business out there. What that means for us is we pride ourselves on really getting the word out into the market, not about just what we do and who we are, but teaching business owners about smart access to credit, partnering with organizations like Nabo, who really put entrepreneurship and smart growth at the center of their message and their philosophy, and getting in front of companies and small businesses through those associations, through those partnerships, and through those organizations in order to make sure that, you know, customers hear about our product and our brand. Beyond that, it's also working with our very strategic partners like Intuit, QuickBooks, like Eventbrite, and a handful of others to make sure that we're showcasing our solution and our product in a way that makes sense to the business owners we work with. And what I mean by that is credit has to not only be accessible, it has to be put in a place where it makes sense. If we're partnering with a payroll company, for instance, and business owners tend to need credit when they're short on making payroll for one cycle, we try to make sure that we contextualize credit and put it in a place where business owners will benefit from seeing it. That means in that case that wherever they're usually processing their payroll might be where we want to partner with a company like Gusto to surface a in-payroll app integration for our Fundbox solution and extend credit to users there using Gusto's data. Again, contextualizing credit, I think, has been the biggest boon for us, whether that's embedding Fundbox into the invoicing portion of QuickBooks or FreshBooks, or building a custom integration around funding events for Eventbrite. We really pride ourselves on putting access to credit in the middle of a business owner's workflow, given how busy and how little time business owners typically have.
You know, there's a lot of talk these days about reducing friction, and the businesses that do the best job of removing or reducing friction are those that have the highest customer adoption and customer loyalty. And I think you've just really explained how you're doing that at Fundbox by the integration that you've just explained. So that's fantastic and really exciting. Let's dive even deeper into that, Basile, because I know that in preparation for our conversation here, you talked about ways that you're leveraging technology and specifically some AI technology to really give Fundbox a competitive edge. So you want to speak to that?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, Bernie, that breaks out into two main ways for us. Obviously, access to data, understanding data, leveraging data is in our DNA. It's what our company is built around. And I mean that across every level, from, you know, how it manifests itself in our product and our underwriting, to how we leverage user insights and data to make for a better product experience. But also, even deeper than that, how we use and leverage artificial intelligence, automation, and other newly available technologies to achieve best-in-class operational efficiency across the business. Where I stand, what that means, right, is for our sales organization, for example, calling on tools like Conversica or other marketing automation solutions in order to deliver very tailored and effective messaging to our customers at the right time without requiring constantly staffing up our operation to maintain the right voice and the right touch in front of our customers. So again, to kind of tie that back, it operates across every spectrum of our business. It's really within our product. And even deeper, it's within how we do business and how we think about making the business here at Fundbox more efficient.
Okay. So what I heard you say, Basile, is that you're leveraging AI technology at two levels, the product level and the business level. Can we come back to the product level just a little bit? I want to just give the listener some insight into how you're leveraging that inside the product level. And then I also want to come back to the business side and unpack that a little bit, because you kind of hit the treetops on both. So let's go back to the product level a little bit. You're using some machine learning, is that right?
That's correct, exactly. And the idea behind that, very simply, is we look at these structured data sources, again, like QuickBooks, like FreshBooks, these accounting and ERP solutions, to make sense of how a business is performing, not by looking at their traditional indicators, but by looking at the systems they use every day to maintain and run their business. And for us, what that means, right, is understanding every little keystroke that goes into using QuickBooks. How frequently is a business owner maintaining their books, and how accurately does it reflect the health of their business? What is the flow in and out of an accounting software, not just from a dollar standpoint, but from a data standpoint as well? How reliable is the data source that we're looking at? And we use these machine learning algorithms that we've developed over the past now 5 years that we've honed over that time period to really understand what kind of tolerance this customer would have for a loan for credit. We also then kind of take that a step further, right? Knowing the accounting data in your QuickBooks is a great first step. But there's a lot of reasons why that by itself might not necessarily be the best way to underwrite a customer. There's, you know, concerns from everything like fraud to just the quality of the data itself. And so we have layers that are built on top of that initial data underwriting using machine learning that feeds a bunch of other third-party data to really get a better holistic picture of who that business owner and that business are. For example, right, once a business owner connects to QuickBooks, we'll actually parse that data, process it, understand a first kind of level of granularity of that business owner's performance, and then we'll layer on data like Emailage or Cortera to understand, hey, has this business been associated with any filings or judgments by the IRS? Does this business maintain a strong social media presence? Does this business have a history of working with other companies that are also connected in our network? And by building out this very interconnected, data-driven network of businesses across our portfolio, we're able to leverage much more than just QuickBooks itself. We're able to use QuickBooks as a matching point to connect to a million different other data sources and really enrich that machine learning model.
Interesting. It's very, very fascinating because it really, it turns the whole traditional business model upside down. And I'm sure that was very well thought out. It sounds like it's probably something that continues to evolve almost on a weekly or monthly basis, just as these technology platforms evolve as well.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. And, you know, I think you hit on a really good point there. It's kind of fascinating to me. And part of the reason I was so passionate about taking this role in the first place, I just could not believe that when you look at the richness of the data that's available everywhere, no one else was doing this. You know, part of what struck me is you hear a lot about the growth in fintech and how companies are using data to provide better decisions. But when you look across the spectrum at how companies are doing that, really what that's translated to for the past, you know, half decade or so is fintechs using data to streamline the application process, not to fundamentally change it. You know, when people ask us, who are you really threatening in the market, with disruption being the big word these days, I wouldn't actually say we're primarily going after the Wells Fargos and the Citibanks of the world at all. Actually, I think the companies that are really feeling kind of the heat from the work we're doing are much more on the credit agency and underwriting side, like Experian, TransUnion, et cetera. Because at the end of the day, we're kind of tipping the scales on how to build pictures of customer health, and other fintech companies haven't kind of gone across the divide of saying, look, we're willing to actually make a bet and not rely on traditional data to really build models from the ground up. The reality is, right, Bernie, I think there's a big barrier for doing this. And if you're familiar with fintech, the challenge with learning machine learning modeling in the first place, to figure out who a good customer is, you really have to understand who a not so good customer is. And that requires some appetite and some tolerance for putting good and bad data into your system to really train these models to understand and recognize good and bad behavior so that you can make the right decisions. The first 3 or 4 years at Fundbox were tough from the standpoint that we had to have a lot of appetite for understanding the entire spectrum. And that's how we managed to get to where we are. It's also why companies like Intuit, QuickBooks, like Eventbrite, who are massive companies, but don't specialize in credit, don't have the appetite to incur, you know, call it losses and really building out these models over years. They'd much rather partner with a company like us, who's already gotten that experience and that learning under its belt, to really just drive to results quickly.
Fantastic. Let's go back to now the business side, because you've just done a fantastic explanation, a fascinating explanation of the disruption of the marketplace, access to credit, and the innovative way that you're doing it at Fundbox. So let's unpack a little bit the innovative ways that you're going to market. What I'm thinking about, Basile, is that you've got this keen insight and understanding into the marketplace and how it's been evolving and this the whole disruption angle. How much of that translates into your marketing and sales activities?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it permeates everything we do, right? And when I say it's in our DNA, I really mean that from the bottom to the top. Every decision we make at Fundbox is driven, it starts by gut and is really confirmed by data. We really, really pride ourselves on just collecting insights and data across the organization to drive to the most effective results for our customers. I'll give you a very practical example of that before going in kind of the technology side of things. Even from a philosophical standpoint, part of why our sales and support teams are combined today at Fundbox is because I fundamentally believe that our sales team in particular is uniquely positioned to be a source of insights gathering, data, and feedback for our marketing and our product design teams. More specifically, right, my customer success team of now 6 employees here at Fundbox is not just calling on accounts and understanding the business and really diving into the need behind the need and trying to get them to understand the value of Fundbox. No, they're actually going one level deeper and understanding what needs to change or what needs to be better in our product to drive even more utilization. And not just understand that empirically, but actually collect data and feed that data back systematically through tracking in Salesforce, through tracking in a variety of different systems, and meet with our product teams on a very, very regular basis to have data-driven conversations around X amount of users had an issue with this and Y amount of users really enjoyed that, so that we can, again, have high impact decisions when it comes to product road mapping and product development to maximize the benefit. So really at a first level, every customer-facing team in the organization is there first and foremost as a customer success piece and component, but as a secondary component, really an insights gathering team to help our non-customer facing part of the business really make the right decisions and achieve the right impact for our users. That really is kind of the first cut. So once we have that in place, once we understand how our users can benefit, you know, from changes in the product, from changes in our underwriting standards, from changes in the user experience, we then take it to another level and say, look, we have two options here. We want to constantly be an automated solution for our users, but have a human element when they need us. And what that requires in this day and age is one of two things: either making big investments in staffing up our team to have a very large team of customer success and support agents. That's one way to do it. And that's absolutely one of the things we've done. But beyond that, how do we make each person within the organization more effective with each customer they have? And conversely, how do we make sure that one person can cover a much broader area from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. every day and not just have to be focused on a very small book of business? How do I make sure that my customer success managers come across a breadth of different conversations across industries, across customer types, and aren't zeroing in on a very small piece of our customer segments simply because of the technological limitations of getting in front of those users? So what that's meant for us, right, is using technologies like Pardot on the marketing automation side to really tailor the messaging between our customers and our customer success agents. It's meant leveraging things like Conversica to create artificial intelligence outreach in the background and really feed to our sales reps and our customer success reps, customers who are engaging with artificial intelligence to take things to the next step. But again, the equation that I constantly solve for with my team is not how can we just grow our team size, but rather how can I grow the number of customers that each team member can handle effectively while improving our satisfaction and resolution scores, right? How do I make sure that things like Conversica, like Pardot, obviously like Salesforce, are in service of making every person more effective and more efficient? And machine learning and artificial intelligence play a huge role in that for us. You know, I use Conversica a lot here. I think it's in large part because to us, we've been growing with Conversica since their early days. And one of the things that I've loved in leveraging that technology is it's adapted to our very specific needs in the lending industry. I'll give you a very, you know, kind of detailed example.
Yeah.
Lending is tricky for a few reasons. Very hard to make sure that we're both giving our customers the right level of information while also being mindful of regulations and standards in the industry that have to be maintained and enforced. And so how do you trust something like artificial intelligence to strike that balance, to say the right thing at the right time when you don't have pure control over it? Well, to us, it meant working extensively with the team at Conversica to make sure that every possible version of that artificial intelligence messaging could fall within the lines of compliance and could fall within the lines of the right regulation requirements. And today, you know, we leverage Conversica at very specific key points, not to give our customers difficult decisions or information per se, but actually to facilitate them getting in front of our customer success teams. Again, it can mean everything from scheduling to times to find a better point of connection to when to schedule a follow-up call to a success call that happened earlier that week. So scheduling and AI are a huge component for us. Conversica makes sure that the customer success team is constantly delivering value and information and not spending their time sending out calendar invites and chasing down, you know, the next phone call, but really just having conversations around who are you as a business owner? What are you looking for as a business owner? And how can Fundbox best serve those needs? Again, 100% of their time being spent on things that are value added to our customers, not things that are administrative tasks that are required to get to those conversations in the first place.
We'll be back in a moment with my conversation with Basil Senesi. Your salespeople want to spend all their time talking with prospects who are interested in your products and services. Imagine if you had a sales development rep sending friendly and personable email messages crafted in response to a lead's initial inquiry. Emails that are sent in a friendly and conversational style that don't include unnecessary graphics or links. This sales development rep never sleeps or gets sick. Conversica is AI-powered sales conversion management software that functions as a sales development rep who helps confirm phone numbers from leads and confirms their interest in talking with your sales rep. Imagine finding hot leads among the hundreds or thousands of inbound leads that you create. Send your sales reps only leads from people who say, yes, I want to talk with a rep. Learn more at conversica.com. So, Vasil, I want to cover one more topic before we get into the summary and the wrap up here. But, you know, you mentioned that you've been working now with tools like Pardot and Conversica and harnessing the AI technology that's available there for the better part of a year or more. So what are some lessons learned? You know, if you were able to go back to the first month, or even just to help our listener who perhaps, you know, hasn't embraced AI technologies in their marketing efforts, what are some of the lessons that you've learned that you'd like to share?
I think it's a few things. One of the big things that I've learned over the past, you know, year or two, and it's interesting because it's slightly antithetical to this being in our DNA. I think it starts with a gut, and it starts with really wanting to take a leap of faith and understanding that there can be a better way to do things and not getting analysis paralysis on trying to zero in on exactly how. For us, Conversica, and actually I'll be the first to admit this, the same thing was true with Pardot. I had a bit of a difficult time relinquishing control over that messaging and really trusting a tool to handle it for us. Part of it was, I know it can help, but the amount of time involved in setting it up effectively, the troubleshooting that's going to have to go into this, I'm just not sure we're at a place where we can afford that time. Well, I wish we had started it a whole year earlier, because the reality is the gains that we've gotten over time have far outpaced any investment we made up front in setting things up and getting them off the ground. And for us, we learned a lot as we went. You just don't know what you're going to come across with respect to implementation, tailoring the messaging, honing the approach and the process until you really get underway, roll up your sleeves, and start doing the heavy lifting. And once we did start to do that, it was actually a lot simpler than I ever expected. So I think that's really one, is just jump in and don't be afraid, because things will start making a lot more sense along the way. But number two, well, the reality is we might be experts in lending. We're not inherently experts in marketing automation or, you know, messaging artificial intelligence, but there are tons of companies out there who are, and they're very willing to educate us and educate any of their customers on how to get the most value out of it. So the second point I really make is just don't be afraid to leverage your vendors and the companies and partners that you call on to deliver best-in-class customer experience. People out there know how to make sure that your vision turns into reality, and they're willing to work tirelessly if you ask for it to make that happen for you.
Absolutely. Those are two excellent points, although I jotted down more than two. So, and we'll see how well I cover that in my wrap-up. And actually, I think we're there. I'd like to get to my wrap-up. You've covered a lot here, Vasil, and so I'm going to attempt to summarize the key points that we discussed. And then I'm going to ask you to respond and perhaps either fill in any holes, or maybe there's a point that I jog your memory on that you'd like to make before we close out this podcast episode.
That sounds perfect. And I'll thank you for taking all those notes, because I know that this topic can go in a bunch of different directions. So thanks for keeping it structured.
Yeah. And there's some complexity to it. I mean, we talked about the beginning of the conversation, we talked about the company Fundbox. Who are you? What do you guys do? You're a small business lending platform, and you kind of turn the whole access to credit model upside down, disrupted perhaps not the banking industry, but those who provide credit. And your role at the company is to oversee both customer acquisition and customer support. You mentioned that you're really in charge of the voice of the customer, and your approach to the marketplace from a product standpoint is by integrating into technology products like the QuickBooks and the FreshBooks and the Eventbrites of the world, where you actually gain access into how businesses are using those tools within their business. And by tapping into the data, you're able to, using machine learning, understand how businesses are using those tools and technologies, then giving you the insight into what credit they might need, what kind of appetite they might have for it, et cetera, and then really being able to engage with those businesses and help them gain access to the credit that they need in a healthy way without taking on too much credit, without, you know, really risking their business. It's really inserting credit at the point of where they need it so that it's truly a need that is served within the business. We talked about how you're harnessing technology, marketing technology, and AI from a go-to-market and a competitive edge standpoint. And you said it's really at two levels. There's the product level, and then there's the business operational efficiency level. At the product level, I'm sure I can't do it the justice that you did, Basile, in explaining how it works. But And just reviewing my notes here, what I came to understand is that you truly are harnessing machine learning to, I think I really just covered this to some extent, by understanding how a business is using a tool like a QuickBooks and then tapping into that data and the insights that you gain from that in order to deliver access to credit recommendations. And then at the business operational efficiency level, you're able to sort of marry intuition, you know, what you call the gut of what you think should be done, and then marrying that with data, even, you know, across the entire business, including sales and support, which is why you've got sales and support under yourself as one leader. And you mentioned that the customer success team is really focused on understanding what the customer's needs are so that you can not only help the customer gain access to the credit that they need, but also improve product usage, the Fundbox product usage. And that ultimately it's really about sort of bringing together the automation, the efficiencies of sale that are available through automation, along with the human element, so that you can give your customer success team access to the information, the insights, and the customer touch points that they need. Mention how you're using both Pardot for marketing automation and Conversica to manage all that, and how you're using Conversica in particular to really extend your messaging and doing it in a very scalable way, deliver tailored messaging to help you grow the customer base as well as the customer usage. And you're really allowing each person within your team to be as efficient as possible because, again, you're harnessing both the technology that's very scalable along with the customer touch point. And then we kind of wrapped on the lessons learned. You know, you said that using all this technology allows you to, and I think I've made this point probably three times already, integrate the gut of what you think needs to be done along with the data to make decisions. And how one big lesson that you learned was needing to trust the tool to handle things like messaging at scale and really enabling your technology partners to go through the process that they can go through to deliver best in class service to you so that you can in fact trust the tool. And you mentioned that you wish you had started a year earlier because you're experts in lending, not experts in marketing automation. So the best in class customer experiences have really enabled you to ramp up and deliver great results. So that's my summary. Is there anything that you'd like to add at any level?
Wow. Yeah. First off, you're not kidding. We did cover a lot in that half an hour here. Impressive. But yes, I think, you know, to take that even one point further, at the end of the day, the fundamental underpinning of this, I think there's a lot of aversion and fear across tech that, hey, what will AI do to human tailoring and human personalization? And my general philosophy on that is like, look, artificial intelligence is here to stay. Automation is here to stay. And we should view that as a tool to enhance what we do best and remove what doesn't need to be done through menial work. Again, I mean, taking the example of the customer success team, how do I make sure that they're spending 100% of their time delivering value to our customer? And how do we call on automation and artificial intelligence to do the rest? We've been very successful in achieving that. That's part of why we've been able to keep our people here happy, keep our customers happy while always growing without necessarily requiring constant investment on team size, et cetera, and still maintain that automated but human angle. That's only thanks to artificial intelligence and data, and we plan on doubling down on that over the coming years.
Yeah, I agree. If I can say that in slightly different words, and that is enabling or allowing the technology, AI-powered technology, to do what it can do really well and at scale, and then enabling people to do what they can do really well, and bringing those two together for the best customer experience and the best operational efficiency.
That's spot on.
Fantastic. Well, Vasil, thank you so much for joining me on this podcast. I think we could have gone for a couple of hours. My mind was racing as we were talking, but we can't do that. So, Vasil, where would you like to send people to connect with you online and learn more about Fundbox?
Yeah, Bernie. So if you want to find out more about Fundbox or engage with me, the easiest way is to go to my LinkedIn, linkedin.com/Vasil Senezi. That's Vasil-Senezi. And you can always visit our website at fundbox.com. Our number is posted right there on the website as well. So feel free to reach out and get in touch with us.
Fantastic. Vasil, thank you so much for joining me on this episode of the Social Business Engine podcast.
Thank you, Bernie. It's a pleasure.
Well, I hope that you enjoyed my conversation with Vasil Senesi, head of sales and support at Fundbox. You know, my big takeaway from this conversation is, and Vasil said it, the power and sophistication of automation is not going to go away anytime soon. In marketing and sales, our opportunity is to harness it to remove menial tasks from people because those tasks can be handled better and also at scale by technology. And when we hand off menial stuff to technology, we maximize the potential impact that our people can have on the customer experience, especially when technology can give our people the insights that they need to deliver a great customer experience. As we heard Basile explain how Funbox is harnessing the power of AI technology and human interaction to deliver a great customer experience. Hey, what was your takeaway from my conversation with Basile Senesi, head of sales and support at Funbox? Hey, this episode is sponsored by Conversica, AI software for marketing and sales that fosters real conversations to discover the most qualified sales opportunities. Learn more at conversica.com. Hey, did you know that Vengresso has two podcasts? You're listening to Social Business Engine. Our other podcast is Selling with Social, hosted by Vengresso's CEO, Mario Martinez Jr. You can subscribe to both our podcasts at our website at vengresso.com. Also, be sure to engage with us on social media. We are at GoVengresso on Twitter, and we're Vengresso on LinkedIn, Facebook, and Instagram. As for me, I'm plain old at Bernie Borges on pretty much every social media channel that I engage on, which is mostly LinkedIn, Twitter, and Instagram. Well, hey, that is a wrap for episode 225. I want to thank my guest once again, Basile Senesi, head of sales and support at Funbox. This is Bernie Borges, CMO of Vengresso, signing off for now and wishing you continued success on your social business journey.
Thank you for listening to the Social Business Engine podcast. Be sure to tune in again next week to reconnect with Bernie Borges for more insights, inspiration, and practical advice on social business. Visit socialbusinessengine.com to catch even more content on social strategy that will rock your business and your career.